The refrigerator, invented in the 18th century, but it was not until the post-World War II era that it became a household must-have for many Americans. The fridge, as it became known, was now more affordable and much safer. New technology had replaced coolants like sulfur dioxide and ammonia with a much safer and unreactive alternative. In time, the refrigerator spread to more of the world, with models to suit the budget. Yet much of the world remained without electricity and running water. And even today, a refrigerator remains an elusive luxury for millions of people in developing countries. Welcome again. Today we examine topic 5.6, depletion of stratospheric ozone, as we outline the overall structure and composition of the atmosphere, describe the role of ozone in the absorption of ultraviolet radiation, state the effects of ultraviolet radiation on living tissues and biological productivity, explain the interaction between ozone and halogenated organic gases, describe three methods of reducing the manufacture and release of ODS, ozone-depleting substances, and finally, we describe and evaluate the role of national and international organizations in reducing the emissions of ozone-depleting substances. The structure of the atmosphere, with the troposphere spanning approximately 15 kilometers and occupying that area between the surface of the Earth and the stratosphere. It is within the troposphere that most atmospheric phenomena occur. It is where the air is at its thickest, and there are significant concentrations of carbon dioxide, oxygen, and nitrogen. The stratosphere is a thin layer that occurs just above the troposphere. Above the stratosphere lies the mesosphere, the thermosphere, and the exosphere. It is within the stratosphere that a key component exists: oxygen in a triatomic form, or O3, ozone. It is important to recognize that ozone exists in relatively small amounts in the stratosphere when compared to diatomic oxygen, O2, but at no other point in the atmosphere is the concentration of ozone as high as it is in the stratosphere. The presence of O3 in the stratosphere is of great significance to the status of life on Earth, for it is the ozone molecule which shields the Earth against significant doses of harmful ultraviolet radiation. Significant amounts of ultraviolet A traverse the layer and end up at the Earth's surface, but the ozone layer, as it's called, plays an important role in shielding the Earth from harmful ultraviolet B radiation, with all of the UVC dissipated well before it reaches the surface of the Earth. Were it not for this ozone shield, the levels of skin cancers would rise, and so would the number of cataracts. Crop production would decline, and most significantly, phytoplankton, which are key producers for the aquatic food chain and their immediate consumers, the zooplankton, would be greatly affected by increased amounts of ultraviolet radiation. An air conditioning unit in the 1970s. These devices, like the refrigerator, were to become widely used in the developed world throughout the 20th century, benefiting from the invention and the application of the magic molecule. This magic molecule is better known as the CFC, or the chlorofluorocarbon, a molecule with carbon at its center and two fluorine atoms and two chlorine atoms joined at the four vertices of a tetrahedron. But the application of the CFC did not stop at cooling systems. The magic molecule was employed as an aerosol propellant, sending everything from deodorant to spray paint into the air at the push of a finger. Then came styrofoam containers, those convenient throwaway items that prevented us from having to wash the dishes. A halogen relative of the CFC, methyl bromide, played a key role in soil fumigation, ridding the soil of pests. With the advent of computers in the latter part of the 20th century, CFCs were employed as cleaners in the manufacturing process. Yet, despite all of these applications, most of the consumption of halogenated hydrocarbons occurred in the developed countries. It was during the 20th century that we came to fully understand the role of ozone and oxygen in shielding the Earth from ultraviolet radiation. While most of the stratosphere is composed of diatomic oxygen, or O2, the small amounts of O3, ozone, play a significant role in shielding the Earth from UV rays. In fact, there is a delicate balance between the amounts of ozone and oxygen in the stratosphere, with a steady state equilibrium existing between oxygen, which breaks up into two single atoms of oxygen when it absorbs UV, only to allow the single atom to combine with O2 to form ozone. Ozone, in turn, takes a significant blow for the Earth and shields us of large chunks of UV, and in so doing, breaks up into O2 and a single atom of oxygen, only to allow more ozone to be formed as a result of a reverse reaction. This process is continually in motion, giving rise to the so-called steady state equilibrium. There is a very delicate balance between ozone and oxygen as the Earth is shielded from harmful ultraviolet rays. The potential for chlorine or any of its halogen relatives, such as fluorine or bromine, to react with ozone and oxygen was well understood for some time. But owing to the very inert and unreactive nature of the CFC, scientists did not foresee any issues of free radicals of chlorine being formed in the presence of the sun's UV rays and then wreaking havoc upon ozone. So when in the 1980s, a group of British scientists working in the South Pole in Antarctica measured the levels of ozone in the ozone layer and found a significant decline in ozone, they doubted whether this could be true. and they retested and found that the ozone levels over the South Pole, especially during the months of September and October, early springtime in the Southern Hemisphere, was alarmingly low. They were left in awe as to what was the cause of this shift in the balance. Indeed, it was time to sound the alarm bells. Suddenly, the ozone hole, as it became called, was in the headlines, and the need to stay out of the sun became ever more urgent. With the harmful effects of ultraviolet radiation already well established, it was not long before world leaders met at a global summit. First, a convention on substances that deplete the ozone layer in Vienna, Austria, and then for the landmark Montreal Protocol in Canada. By that time, science had fully grasped the reasons for the ozone depletion. The answer lied in the unique meteorology of the region, and specifically on the high altitude, very cold ice particles of the polar stratospheric clouds. It was upon these clouds that chlorine from the CFCs became sequestered or collected in HCl and chlorine nitrate. And during the long 6 months of winter in the Southern Hemisphere, these molecules were able to interact, finding suitable conditions upon the ice particles of the polar stratospheric clouds. During the long polar night, a large reservoir of Cl2, diatomic chlorine gas, was able to collect. Upon the first light of spring, this reservoir of chlorine unleashed an army of chlorine-free radicals. And now, the unthinkable became reality, as large volumes of ozone suddenly became converted into oxygen and single atoms of oxygen. The single atoms of oxygen were also sucked up by the ClO molecules, regenerating free radicals of chlorine that could repeat the process over and over again. And in so doing, they were able to tilt the balance in the ozone layer. Most of the significant blockage of harmful UV is carried out by ozone. And with this shift in the balance, the Earth was at the mercy of UV radiation. The need for action was immediate. Science had already established cause and effect, and it was now up to world leaders and managers and engineers to find the solutions. Fortunately, an excellent short-term solution was at hand. This time, the magic molecule was the hydrofluorocarbon, also known as tetrafluoroethane, a close yet significantly different relative of the CFC. This molecule would not present any threat to stratospheric ozone, but it's important to note that it has a very high potential for trapping infrared radiation and enhancing the greenhouse effect. Soon, HCFCs would fill the aerosol cans, which all sported the new eco-friendly labels of no CFCs. CFCs were carefully collected and disposed of from old refrigerators and air conditioners. Developed countries took responsibility upon themselves for setting rigid deadlines for phase-out of ozone-depleting substances, granting additional concessions and support to the developing world and the less developed countries, for their contribution to the problem was significantly less than that of the more developed countries. Such was the success of the Montreal Protocol that it prompted the former Secretary General of the United Nations, Kofi Annan, to describe it as perhaps the single most successful international agreement to date. Perhaps the most significant reason behind the success of the Montreal Protocol was its adherence to the principle of common but differentiated responsibility, with the developed countries, the MEDCs, taking the lead and willing to phase out ODS in the short term while giving extensions to nations like China and India to follow up with a later date for their phase-out. Other reasons for the success and the prompt action include the fact that science was able to clearly identify the cause and the effect, and then they were able to provide a cheap and viable alternative in the form of the HCFC. The cost of implementing the solution, changing over from CFC to HCFC, was minimal, and when weighed up against the benefits, it was a very easy decision to make. So the cost-benefit analysis looks something like this, with the cutting back or the abatement of ODS moving in this direction, and for each unit of CFCs that's phased out, the benefit shown here. But what was the cost of this phase out? Because the cost of it was so low because of the ease of implementing the solution, then significant amounts of reduction occurred, bringing the level to this equilibrium point here, where the green overlaps with the blue. And it's just a matter of time before complete phase-out occurs and the green line becomes yellow. The current equilibrium is at this point, however, for there is still some additional phase-out that remains. For the moment, however, there are still some ODS that go into the atmosphere. These come from sources like metered dose inhalers, which receive special exemption from the provisions of the Montreal Protocol and the Clean Air Act in the United States. Another exempted category is methyl bromide, which was officially phased out in the US in 2005, but still receives a QPS, or a quarantine and pre-shipment exemption, for use in controlling pests in foods that are shipped overseas.